Dig, dig, dig.
Dig?
Oh, good girl. Good girl.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back. You know, normally I'd say welcome back to the Valley of the Last Dinosaurs, but of course, today we actually walked right out of the valley and up here to the top of Camel Butte, and I'm sitting here with a good friend, Dr. Stephen Chester, from the City University of New York, and he's also a teacher at Brooklyn College.
That's right.
Cool. And Stephen, you're a mammalian paleontologist, is that right?
That's true. I'm a paleontologist, and I'm also a mammal.
Okay, I see what you did there. But you're also a paleontologist who studies fossil mammals, am I right?
Exactly.
Okay, I understand. So what brings you out here? I see you around the lab all the time. Why are you in the Marmoth field area?
So my crew's been here for about 2 weeks. We just got back from field work in Wyoming, where we were studying the Eocene. And the Eocene started about 56 million years ago. This is about 10 million years after the end Cretaceous extinction event. And this is a really interesting time because it's marked by the appearance of modern orders of mammals. So perissodactyls, things like the earliest horses, artiodactyls, ancestors of pigs and deer. This is the first appearance of primates of modern aspect. So primates that actually look quite a bit like, for example, the lemurs on Madagascar today.
Oh, cool, cool. So, and you come all the way to Marmoth. This is sediments in Paleocene age, right?
It is. And really, when it comes to those modern orders, the big question is, you know, where did they come from? So in order to figure that out, we have to go deeper back in time. That's why we're interested in the Paleocene. That's why we're even potentially interested in the Cretaceous.
Oh, that makes sense. You're pushing that research in mammalian evolution all the way back. Exactly. To the extinction event of the dinosaurs.
Exactly, yeah. So lots of times when people think about the extinction event, they think about the fact that the non-avian or the non-bird dinosaurs went extinct. But this is actually a really important time period for mammals as well. It's also a really important time for primates. It turns out that the first primate Purgatorius shows up just within 100,000 years of the extinction event.
Oh, wow, that close to the boundary.
Yeah, exactly. So my colleagues and I actually just described some ankle bones of Purgatorius, and it demonstrates that primates were already in trees shortly after dinosaurs went extinct.
Wow, so now I understand why you're out here working with Dr. Leeson on those sediments that record the very first moments after the extinction event.
Exactly. So the Marmoth area is really amazing because it has a lot of earliest Paleocene sites that are really close to the boundary, so just meters above the boundary, just like this one. So that allows us to quantify patterns of survival and recovery for the mammals and lots of other vertebrates. I've known Tyler since we were in grad school together, started coming out here several years ago. And he's brought me out to some of his Cretaceous sites where I've looked for mammals. He's also joined me and my collaborator, Dr. Eric Sargis, focusing more on the recovery. So we're focused on the mammals, but Tyler's helped us out with the turtles, the crocs, the fish, lots of other fossils that we find at these sites.
Cool. The mammals sound really cool. Tell me, what kind of fossils are you looking for out here?
So for the most part, even though we'd love to find complete articulated skeletons, for the most part, we just find isolated teeth and jaw fragments. So enamel's the hardest part of the body. That's why it preserves so well in the fossil record. Lots of people always ask me, you know, what can you do with a tooth? Like, oh, okay, all you found was an isolated tooth. But it turns out that you could learn a lot from teeth. So teeth are really informative when it comes to body mass. So if you just have the dimensions of a molar, you can estimate how large a mammal actually was. Based on the size and the shape of teeth, you could figure out what animals were eating. And also, you could just look at the shape of teeth and try to figure out which mammals are more closely related to each other.
That's interesting. I noticed you said you can tell a lot about the body mass. I understand these mammals you're looking for are much smaller than the dinosaurs that we've been studying for the last couple of weeks.
Right. So lots of these mammal teeth are actually just millimeters in length and width. They're extremely small. That's why we use some of the methods that you could see behind us. There's my collaborator and some of my students, and they're using fine screens to basically sort out a bunch of matrix looking for really, really tiny bones. The teeth are so small that you most of the time you can't even find them in the field. We just bag up all of the sediment, bring it back to the lab, and we find these fossils back there when we're sorting.
I can imagine. This countryside is so vast out here, and you're looking for things in that millimeter size class. I can just imagine. It's like finding a needle in a haystack.
It really is. So, and we've actually found some really incredible fossils that are back at the lab, so it would be great if you and your crew could come take a look.
Oh, that'd be cool. Maybe I can bring the live side crew in, and we could take a look at some of the really awesome stuff that you've been pulling out of the ground right here at Camel Butte.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
Well, Dr. Chester, I better let you get back to work. It's been really cool. I'm glad we had an opportunity to talk today.
Yeah, me too. And one fun thing to think about is that we actually wouldn't even be having this conversation right now if it wasn't for the extinction event. So, you know, mammals were around during the time of the dinosaurs, but dinosaurs really dominated these terrestrial ecosystems. It's not until the extinction event where you see this major radiation of mammals that gave rise to all the mammals that you see today, including ourselves.
Oh, man. Well, I love my dinosaurs. I never really thought about it in that way, but I guess in terms of mammalian evolution, primate origins, and of course our human story, it is really lucky that that asteroid sort of made the dent that it did.
Exactly.
Well, guys, thanks a lot for tuning in, and we'll catch you next week, and you guys can tune in to see Dr. Chester's awesome laboratory. See ya.